Okay, welcome back. So, without any further ado, I'll welcome Dr. K. Egan from Aberystwyth University up to the podium to talk about the video nasties phenomenon in Britain and a little bit about the impact of that afterwards.
Okay, so hello everyone. As Rest said, I'm focusing on the video nasties. That's the focus of my paper today. And I was very interested to see that when Rest asked you if you'd heard of it, only one gentleman here at the front, I think, had. Which is good, because I'm going to give you a lot of background about where the term comes from, how it relates to horror, and also to politics as well. So it's kind of an umbrella term, really, because it refers primarily to a group of horror films that were targeted by a press campaign in Britain in the early 1980s. But over time, within the UK context anyway, it's come to be implied as almost kind of like a generic label or a subgeneric label for a kind of horror film. And that's developed out of this moral panic, really, in interesting ways. So first of all, to give you a bit of background about what the nasties are, how they came into existence, if you like. They're kind of a ragbag group of films from a variety of different horror production traditions, which began, and this is the only thing that really unites them, to be released in many cases for the first time onto the UK video market in the early 1980s. And at that time, there was no kind of voluntary or compulsory regulation of any kind governing these videos. So they were released without age certificates, without the need to be approved by any kind of censorship body at all. And they were marketed in a very kind of distinctive way. So that had an impact. So largely as a result of the video advertisements and the video sleeves that accompanied these films onto the video market at that time, calls started to be put into place for these films to be maybe not banned, but at least some kind of curbs put on easy access to them. Particularly, these calls came from right-wing newspapers in the UK, like the Daily Mail, the Times, and the Sun. And as a result of that, the police got involved in the first instance, and the Obscene Publication Squad. They began to seize horror titles from video shops throughout the UK using the 1959 Obscene Publications Act, which had previously been most famously used to prosecute Lady Chatterley's Lever, the D.H. Lawrence novel in the UK, and was now being used to really to think about prosecuting cinema on video. And as a result of these seizures by the police, a list began to be put into place of horror films available on video at this time that were seen to be potentially prosecutable. And that became known as the Video Nasties List. In subsequent years, it would become this list a kind of collector's item. Video collectors would get hold of this list that originally had been put together by the police as a way, as a kind of checklist of obtaining these videos. But this was the kind of origin of the list in the first place, as a police document. Despite those actions, though, by the police, the right-wing press continued to call for stricter restrictions on these videos, and as a direct result of that, the British government of the time, led by Margaret Thatcher, finally met calls to put a system of state censorship into place, and in 1984 passed the Video Recordings Act. And as a result of that, many video distributors that initially were circulating these horror films around the video market in the UK knew that, you know, if they put their films forward for certification to the British censors, that they wouldn't get anywhere. So consequently, most of these films were removed from the shelves of video shops and became banned, technically, from 1984 onwards. So really what we're talking about here is horror cinema and horror cinema's marketing ultimately having enough of a kind of an impact and leading to such a level of moral outrage that a system of state censorship comes into place in the UK. So how did that situation occur? What I want to do now is to stop and think a little bit more, really, about the cultural and political factors that inform those events that I've just outlined very briefly for you, and to then think about how these events actually continue to stick to these films in the UK context and kind of inform their reputations right, I'd say, from the moment of their banning right up until the present day. So, first of all, examples of nasty films. So the films that were put in this category. I don't know if you know, you said you'd heard of the term video nasties. Do you know of any of the films that were associated with the label? Driller Killer, absolutely. The Evil Dead? Evil Speak?
No.
Okay.
Okay, right.
Yeah. Driller Killer is a key one. Absolutely. And I'm going to come back to that in a minute. Here's some other examples, and hopefully they'll give you a sense of the kind of the range of horror films that were put in this particular category. So there was quite a lot of Russ's films that would fit with Russ's area of interest, Italian horror on this list. Going all the way from kind of Mario Bava, films like Bloodbath from 1971, to a range of horror films made by people like Argento and Lucio Fulci. So key horror directors, really, from Italy. A range of their films were on this list. Then you have kind of American drive-in films, or at least films that I would say have been made, really, for that kind of drive-in context in the US primarily. Blood Feast, directed by Herschel Gordon Lewis from 1960, and also, again, quite famous titles now, The Last House on the Left, directed by Wes Craven, and I Spit on Your Grave, which I think was shown at the festival last year. Also, we then have a kind of, well, we have slashers as well, a number of films that would be broadly put in that category of the slasher film, which is obviously very popular in the early 1980s, films like The Burning and The Funhouse, directed by Toby Hooper, who'd made The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And then we also have a kind of mishmash of Italian and Spanish horror films from the 1970s and 80s, Nazi films, cannibal films, zombie films, including films like Cannibal Holocaust and Zombie Flesh Eaters, which again I'm guessing you'd be familiar with. The film that you mentioned there, Driller Killer, which to some degree is kind of a psychological kind of art house horror, I'd say, in many respects. And then probably the most famous film on the list, Sam Raimi's The Evil Dead. So these were, this is the kind of the scope of films that were being focused upon at this time that all became banned as a result of this particular moral panic. And hopefully what that should give you an idea of is how kind of random it was. That really, this is a really real mishmash of films that largely were being picked up by the police from video shops because they seemed, on the basis of their title or the cover, to be something that might be problematic in some way. So it was a rather random and arbitrary process through which these films became associated with that label of the video nasties. And really, if this was kind of the product that video distributors of the time had at their disposal, they did kind of have quite a tough job on their hands in terms of promoting these products on the video market in the early 1980s. So while people like Sam Raimi and Wes Craven and Dario Argento are well-known figures now, they were pretty much unknown in the British context at the time. The films were low budget. They didn't really have any stars in them. And therefore, the distributors, in terms of how they marketed the films, you couldn't blame them, really, for focusing so much on causing offence or provoking, if you like, through the marketing, because the unfamiliar quality of the films was what they had at their disposal to really kind of push the films onto the British market and really give them maximum exposure. So what you're getting at this time, of course, this was the very early years of video, and video was particularly popular in Britain when it first appeared in 1979 and 1980. You have a situation where Britain, notoriously censorious when it had come to horror in the past, even with some of its own horror products, such as the Hammer horror films, had been notorious for censoring them or for kind of outrages occurring around these films. And a lot of horror and kind of horror traditions had kind of been blocked in the UK as a result, or marginalised. So you move from the situation where that was occurring to video arriving, and suddenly that you get a flood of horror everywhere, in corner shops, in video stores, all around the country. Suddenly horror is very visible as a product of the video industry. So it's quite a dramatic time, really, within the UK in terms of shifts in kind of home entertainment. And you have these kind of images that are helping to create that kind of impact at the time. video covers, for instance, like this one, which has become quite infamous. The Driller Killer, directed by Abel Ferrara, was one of the first films that was prosecuted, or attempt to prosecute, was made by the police at this time. It was seized from video shops, clearly because of its title and also because of its cover as well. It's become very infamous, this cover. And I could imagine that if somebody was going into the local shop in their town or whatever and encountering this poster, then it could lead to a fuss being made as a result. Clearly what the distributors have done here is draw on really kind of quite classic exploitation forms of marketing that are perhaps more familiar in the US context than they would have been in the UK at this time. So they've chosen to promote this film with this charming image here, clearly a moment of violence from Driller Killer. So it's an image from the film itself, but possibly not an image that's that representative of the film as a whole, if you've seen it. The film has some violent moments in it, but they're relatively few, and it's kind of, as I said, a psychological art house horror film. But the distributors have gone for this image and promoted it with this image. And in a way, what this image is doing is perhaps conjuring at what you might think the film is about from the title. And that if you look at the tagline, it's basically the blood runs in rivers and the drill keeps tearing through flesh and bone. It's basically just letting our imagination run away with this and telling us that the film is basically what we imagine it to be. And as a result of this, I would argue, what this kind of marketing strategy, and it was one that was employed with many of these films at the time, is doing is giving the impression that this film is just a string of violent moments, that it maybe doesn't have a conventional narrative, or there's no characters mentioned here, for instance. And maybe as a result, presenting this film as being more extreme and unconventional than it actually was, particularly considering the fact that many of these films had been cut of their most violent scenes before they were released onto the video market. So these images were kind of making up for or standing in for what wasn't actually in the film itself. So the absence of violent scenes didn't stop distributors promoting these films like this, or like this, by taking an image from the film and then just very poorly sort of superimposing some fake blood over it to almost create this kind of contrived violent image, or doing something like this, taking a violent idea associated with the film and extending it into a promotional stunt of some kind, which is what the distributors of this film, Nightmares in a Damaged Brain, did by holding a competition where video renters had to guess the weight of the human brain in the jar to win a cash prize. So these were the kind of strategies that were being employed at the time. And as I said, they're not new kind of strategies, really. They come from classic horror and exploitation marketing in the US, but weren't really known forms of marketing within the US context. I mean, the US didn't have a drive-in culture, for instance. So in the UK, it was very unusual, and many people in the UK didn't know what to make of these kind of ways of framing and promoting these films. As well as that, these images were very useful for those who wanted to campaign against the films themselves. They were very rhetorically useful. So all the Daily Mail and the Sun and the Times and these British newspapers needed, really, were these images to spark their imagination, to imagine only what they wanted to imagine about these particular films, and to focus on covers, on kind of out-of-context descriptions of the most violent moments in the films, on the titles, to do all the work for them, rather than the specifics of the films themselves, but actually those marketing ideas, to use those to get people behind them and to create kind of maximum impact for their campaign to ban these particular films. And in order to demonstrate that, I want to show you a series of clips from some documentaries on the Nasties, and there's quite a few now that have been made. And these clips include some news reports from the time, so you can see the extent to which horror became headline news in Britain at this time, but also examples of how the press, politicians, other kinds of campaigners were really centrally focused on video cover images, on marketing, and on titles and descriptions of the films and of particular scenes from the films in terms of promoting their case against them.
In the late 1970s, anxiety about the effects of watching violence was given a new urgency with the coming of home video. And it gave new impetus to the country's campaigners against what they saw as dangerous and corrupting.
Towards the end of 82, 83, our customers' shops started getting raided by the police, confiscating movies that belonged in our catalogue. And we couldn't understand why. I didn't understand why.
What were the reasons given?
They just said that they were considered to be obscene under the Obscene Publications Act.
These are the cassettes, Driller, Killer and Death Trap, the first two of the so-called video nasties to be withdrawn from distribution. In a test case brought under the Obscene Publications Act, Willesden magistrates ordered their immediate forfeiture.
I always thought, well, porn was always a problem, hardcore sex. I mean, you knew that was going to be a problem. Horror films? This is nonsense. People are getting frightened. How can you consider them to be obscene?
In 1983, a private members' bill was passed requiring the censors to certify videos in an attempt to impose some control on what could be watched at home.
The Home Office Undersecretary, David Mellor, told the Commons the bill was absolutely crucial. Video nasties, he said, were cynically intended to inflame brutish and sadistic passions.
Many of the films achieved cult status with their low-budget look, their tongue-in-cheek stories and over-the-top effects.
Sometimes the material just looks so dated and so silly that in the year 2001, it is simply not a runner to suggest that it's going to do harm to people who like to see it. It's got a limited audience, and the audience is more likely to laugh at it than they are to be harmed by it.
Video nasty is not a term of art. It was a journalistic term coined by, I believe, a journalist called Peter Chippendale, who wrote a review of a video trade fair in Manchester either in late 81 or 82 in the Sunday Times. Very long account of the kinds of things that were available at this trade fair, which he described as video nasty.
Britain has the highest proportion of domestic video recorders in the world. And the fear of the protesters has been that obscene videos might fall into the hands of children. Certainly the titles of the works themselves are a catalogue of depravity. Cannibal Holocaust, SS Experiment Cap, I Spit on Your Grave.
First of all, what is a video nasty?
Difficult to define. They are being steadily classified, but it's any film, I mean, it happens to be on a video, but it's a film that includes violence, sadism, horror. You know, you know the sort of horror films that we used to call horror aren't nearly as... They were mild compared with some of these. Things like Killer Driller, horrible titles they've got.
I have never seen a video nasty. I wouldn't. I have far too much...
Well, how can you judge on a video nasty? Oh, you've never seen one.
Look, if somebody tells me, as we get these reports in from Europe, from America, and from this country, that a particular video nasty contains that, 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 and that, I actually don't need to see visually what I know is in that film.
I mean, that's extraordinary, isn't it? It's really extraordinary that somebody would say that they could judge on any film without actually seeing it. But there we are. That was the kind of logic with which this campaign was informed, really, centrally. And what hopefully some of those clips should have illustrated was this kind of pronounced focus on the marketing images, on descriptions of violent moments from the film, films taken out of context. And to me, it really kind of illustrates how, during the course of this campaign, you get through the process of the film's marketing on video and then the reactions to the press to that marketing, the public image of the video nasties becomes slowly less and less dependent on the specifics of these films themselves and much, much more dependent on quite a really kind of abstract idea of what a horror film is and what a nasty horror film is. It moves into the realm of abstract ideas, really, based, patched together on the basis of marketing and titles and second-hand descriptions of these films. That seemed to be what propelled this campaign in many ways, and it was very politically useful for people who wanted to try and ban these films completely from the UK at this particular time. And that was extended by the woman that you saw in the last clip there, Mary Whitehouse, who was one of the most famous moral campaigners. She's quite notorious in the UK as a moral campaigner. She was centrally involved in the Nasties campaign. And to try and get MPs on board with the campaign, she actually arranged for a montage of clips from the films themselves to be screened in Parliament to try and get people on board, get MPs on board and convince them that state legislation to ban these films was something that was kind of really urgently needed. So she was using that logic of taking scenes out of context here within Parliament to get MPs on board. And it led to headlines like this. And these headlines come from the kind of height of the campaign, if you like. So clearly what we're getting here is, because the Nasties had been marketed through video cover images and so on as unfamiliar, extreme films, as almost kind of like the pinnacle of extreme horror, even though some of the films were 20 years old in the case of a film like Blood Feast made in 1960. Because of that, it allowed the press to present these films not as films or as entertainment, but as kind of diseases or drugs, to kind of turn it into a public health issue, really, rather than an issue that was to do with entertainment or the cinema. So you get headlines like these, video filth that warps the minds of our young, this poison being peddled as home entertainment. And as a result of that, it could also present the video distributors as being suspect in this way, because that they were given names in the press like video pushers and filth merchants. They were portrayed in this way because of the fact that this kind of imagery had been put in place to present them as such. They weren't entrepreneurs, which of course Margaret Thatcher was kind of promoting entrepreneurship at this time in this country, in Britain. They instead were filth peddlers that needed to be stopped, really, in terms of what they were doing. And kind of married with that in the press was this idea of the shop, the home, the school in Britain being taken over, almost like an invasion of the body snatchers idea, if you like, taking horror imagery and using it against horror cinema in that way, presenting this kind of nightmare image of Britain being taken over by an epidemic of horror that would have untold consequences, apparently, for our country. But we're all just about fine, I think, many years later. But that was kind of the claim at the time. And once that had become all very effective and persuasive, at least to the readers of these newspapers and their supporters, Mrs. Thatcher then came on board as well and began to also support this campaign to impose governmental state censorship on video rather than leave the industry to regulate itself. And for me, she did this for her own reasons. She got other benefits out of it as well, I would say. So it's fair to say Britain in the early 80s was in a bit of a mess. We have high levels of unemployment, strikes, civil riots over workers' pay. You also have the bloody violence associated with the Falklands War at the time and Britain's invasion of the Falklands. And for people who've written on the video nasties, people like Martin Barker and myself, we've argued that that connection made in this campaign between the violent content of the films and violence in society was very useful to people like Margaret Thatcher, because it allowed them very successfully, I think, to use the banning of these films as a kind of public demonstration that real violence in society was being effectively dealt with. So while in many ways it could be argued that Thatcher's policies had contributed to the strikes and so on that were going on in the UK, She was kind of, in a way, deflecting attention onto these horror films and their banning to show that she was actually doing something to curb violence in our world. And for me, what that suggests, and it's where my interest in the video nasties is really focused, I think, primarily, is how useful horror can be as a political scapegoat in particular societies. So it could be argued that there's actually, and I'm sure many people who've seen some of these films would agree, there's actually very little difference between the average video nasty and the average horror film of the time, of the early 80s. The category of the video nasties was kind of formed really solely because of its promotional usefulness to distributors, and it was useful to them for a time before they had went bankrupt as a result of the banning, but also politically useful as well to the right-wing press because they could then use this category as a way of scapegoating horror in the ways I've described. However, the category didn't go away after the films were banned. As I mentioned, throughout the course of the 80s and into the 90s, collecting cultures developed in the UK focused solely on collecting all of the original video nasties. It was a real kind of classic moment for many people in horror fandom in the UK. Many people talk very fondly of that period of horror fandom. The video nasties became a touchstone for many horror fans in the UK. And as a result of that, in 1992, Vipco, one of the original distributors of some of these films, submitted a number of cut versions of nasty titles from its back catalogue to the censors for certification, and they were approved and released. And as a result of that, Vipco then kind of re-emerged as a British horror specialist on the video market at that time. What was interesting about Vipco was the way in which they marketed the films. It led really to a kind of barrage of these films being released between 2000 and 2007, to the point where now I think pretty much all of the nasty titles have been released either in a cut or an uncut form in the UK. Really, when they came out in 2000, you know, this was a very different climate. The censors in our country, the BBFC, had been liberalised. And many of these films, when they came out, elicited more letters of support than complaint that finally they were back out on the video market. As a result of that, there was little in public outrage. But what Vipco did instead to promote these films was to draw on the legacy of the controversy of the past, really, to use that as a way of presenting these films as horror films with a significant history that was meaningful to many horror fans in the UK. So I went and looked at a range of marketing material over that period when these films were coming back out onto the market. And what was emphasised repeatedly across all of them was that 1980s context and how important it was in terms of framing these films as significant horror films. So many of these films, when they came out, an emphasis was placed on how long they'd been banned and removed from the public eye. So Driller Killer here, for instance, when it came back out, the tagline stated, outlawed for 15 years, banned in this country for over 10 years. Or The Slayer was presented as being seen on the small screen for the first time in 8 years. Also, references to dates were key as well, reference, you know, using that kind of 1982, 1983 as kind of touchstones, referring back to that classic period of horror controversy in the UK. So you get re-release covers stating that Zombie Flesh Eaters includes material banned since 1983, or that the Toolbox Murders was back out after being banned since 1982. So these were the strategies that were being employed at this particular time, and they were very, very effective, I think, because, as I say, they emphasised the fact that these titles had that kind of edge of controversy and illicitness about them. Even though they were back out, they had this kind of history of being films that had shocked and provoked within this country over a long period and had that kind of historical significance and historical meaning for horror fans who experienced that particular era as well. Another strategy that was employed on many of them was to put a label, a logo on them, which stated previously banned, which almost, I mean, that became a real trend not just for video nasties, but a range of films that had been banned and came back out at this time on video, they would have this kind of logo on them, to the point where it seemed to become almost kind of a sub-generic category of DVD marketing at this time. It worked in that way where, for people who had that knowledge of this period and where knowledge of the video nasties as a kind of political event within British horror history had reached its peak amongst a generation of fans, these strategies had kind of meaning for those fans who were the target audience for these DVDs. So in a retrospective article in the British newspaper The Guardian in 2002, Andrew Holmes argued that for a large number of British horror fans, the video nasties era was the first experience for many horror fans in the UK, not only of censorship, but of the media's potential to distort the truth. So these references on these videos clearly are working to symbolise that era, tied up with notions of illicitness, with controversy, subjects which horror is often associated with or entangled and enmeshed with when it interacts with the wider public in different societies. Vipco, that had the charming tagline, "Pioneers of the Video Nasty, established 1979, will never die," the oldest and greatest horror video label in the world, sadly went bankrupt in 2007. But the cultural impact of the video nasty era in the UK is still evident in many products targeted at cult film enthusiasts in the UK, particularly Arrow Video, which have emerged as probably the key DVD, Blu-ray distribution company within the UK for cult and horror and exploitation titles. They're kind of a bit more at market than Vipco. Their website notes, for instance, that Arrow Video brings you the best cult films in deluxe editions with newly commissioned artwork, specially curated extras and booklets, which is a bit more kind of fancy than Vipco, who are rather straightforward with their extra. They didn't put a lot of work into remastering the films when they brought them out. But Arrow still trades in the kind of iconography of 80s video, which has become so important to so many British horror fans in the UK because of the Video Nasties controversy. Much of their DVD artwork is kind of early UK video inspired, if you look at some of these images and also their logo there at the top. And they use, just like the Vipco taglines from the 90s, again, quite exploitation-inspired references to the film's original banning in their ad copy to promote some of these films. So, for instance, the one Greek horror film on the Video Nasties list is promoted in the following way by Vipco in a recent release. It's noted there that Island of Death is a travelogue of atrocities with scenes so strong that the British government was compelled to ban it as a video nasty. Now remember, this is over 20 years later. And as for Zombie Flesh Eaters, when that came out recently, it was promoted with the following copy. From the sleazy video nasty vaults comes a movie so stained with controversy and moral indignation that the very mention of its name sends shudders down the spines of the weak-stomached and censorious. Check out this classic sadistic video and revel in a wonderfully offensive movie that once helped usher in a moral panic. What a way to sell a film. But what it reveals, and what I hope this talk has revealed, and the case study of the nasties, is the way in which you get an association between a group of genre films and an act of censorship, as occurred here. That can be, like it or not, commercially and culturally productive. And that productivity can be maintained through the framing and reframing that can occur when films with a distinct censorship history, like these ones, are released and re-released in home media formats and again at the cinema as well. Thank you.